of vital concern to the armed forces in the defense of our country is leadership. It is a very personal thing, and whatever your rank, this film is intended to make you think about leadership. No nation can number more outstanding examples of battlefield leadership than ours.
At noon on the 18th of June, 1815, at Waterloo, the Scots Greys were ordered to charge the French infantry on the left flank. Sergeant Charles Ewart, leading his troop with great dash and verve, personally captured the eagle of the French 45th Regiment.
On the 13th of January, 1842, Lieutenant Thomas Souter led the last stand of the 44th Regiment against the Afghans at Gandamak during the retreat from Kabul.
On May the 9th, 1915, Pipers of the Black Watch led their company over the top against the Germans.
The Victoria Cross to Major General Jock Campbell in recognition of the most conspicuous gallantry and devotion to duty at Sidi Rezay on the 21st and 22nd of November, 1941. Standing in his car with a blue flag, he personally formed up tanks under close and intense fire from all nature of enemy weapons. He was an inspiration to his men and to all who saw him. His brilliant leadership was the direct cause of the very heavy casualties inflicted on the enemy.
The brilliant leadership of countless great commanders can be our inspiration today. Marlborough, known as Corporal John to his men. Wellington, whose men said of him in a tight corner, "Where's our Arthur? We would rather see his long nose in the fight any day than a reinforcement of 10,000 men." Nelson, of whom Southey wrote, "England has had many heroes, but never one who so entirely possessed the love of his fellow countrymen." Montgomery, known to his men as Monty, and to himself called Churchill the greatest Englishman of all time.
"We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender."
If we are to preserve our way of life in a world of international tension and unrest, preserve our personal liberty, enterprise, and free speech in a time of increasing military imbalance, don't we need leadership as much as ever before? Certainly, the British Army has always demanded the highest standards of leadership at all levels of command. So what is leadership?
10 good soldiers wisely led will beat 100 without a head.
A bishop of Durham once said,
"It is a fact that some men possess a superiority which gives them a dominating influence over their contemporaries and marks them out unmistakably for leadership."
That's the way. Take her along. Take her along. Keep it going. Okay,
it is apparent in every association of human beings, in every variety of circumstances and on every plane of culture. In a school among the boys. In a college among the students. In a factory, shipyard or mine among the workmen, there are those who take the leading place and shape the general conduct.
You've seen it, or something like it, haven't you? The mass stand around helplessly, unable to cope, until someone with that special something, not awed by the situation, steps forward to direct the onlookers into helpful activity, to control the situation, in short, to lead.
"Ask for police and ambulance, say the accident at the junction of Lewin Road and Upper Richmond Road, right?"
"Right, thank you very much."
That something may be hidden in anyone. That someone may be you.
"Okay, so I'll take over now."
And more often than not, is duty done, without demanding thanks, to disappear unselfishly again into the crowd. But is that as far as leadership goes? Just a something in some people that others recognize, accept, welcome, and respect? Something that makes them stand out from others? No, leadership is more than that.
Seid ihr doch mich und alles, was ich bin.
Hitler's leadership was cruelly unjust, anti-human. So were, are, and will be others led by fanatics, dictators, despots. The leader, however great, who backs an evil cause, carries the seeds of his own destruction. Field Marshal Slim, Uncle Bill to his men, said,
"Leadership is that combination of example, persuasion, and compulsion that makes men do what you want them to, whether you command 10 men or 10 million. Leadership is the most personal thing in the world, for the simple reason that leadership is just plain you."
Now, this takes the idea of leadership a great deal further, for it implies a strength of will and character.
Come on, Mr. Ball, sir!
Will can be reinforced. Character can be developed and trained. Trained to burst like a firework into something much greater. The footballer has to have the basic reflexes and ability. But he only succeeds by developing his technique with prolonged practice and experience.
You cover him. You stand in a corner. Watch the minute.
So too, with practice and experience, can the military leader develop.
You and another man will move on to the garage.
Leadership is required in peace and in war, in barracks, on administrative work, and ultimately on the battlefield, where the challenge is to make men overcome their natural instincts of self-preservation. Field Marshal Harding describes it like this.
I would like you to be quite clear about the conditions under which you will have to exercise leadership. You will frequently be tired. You may also be cold and wet and hungry and thirsty. You won't know precisely what is going on, where the enemy is, and what he's going to do, or what his capabilities are. You may not know where your own people are, or what they're going to do. You have got to be able to exercise leadership in conditions of fatigue and fear, uncertainty and ignorance, and often in isolation. That is why leadership on the battlefield calls for the very highest qualities.
Since time immemorial, every great leader has his own deeply held convictions about the qualities of leadership. But few would argue with Bill Slim's short list of 5. Integrity, knowledge, willpower, initiative, and courage. Physical courage in the face of extreme danger, of course. But more important, moral courage. To do what you think is right. Again, Slim said,
"We, the British, have our own special kind of courage. The courage that goes on. And endurance is the very essence of courage.
Willpower. That's something deep inside you that drives you on. A determination to get your way. And it is not to be confused with stubbornness. For willpower is determination to succeed in what you are doing. So that nothing, pettiness, frustration, or the most fearsome assaults launched by the enemy, nothing will defeat you."
General, salute! Present! Arms!
There's no danger about the guards, Knight, that we are going to make it in.
That!
There's no danger.
And then, there's initiative. Do it. Now.
Excuse me, would you like a dance?
Oh, thank you. But I will. I'm here to get thanks.
What's your name?
Donna. What's yours?
Kevin. What do you do?
I work in a boutique. What do you do?
I'm in the army.
Everyone make sure the magazines are in correctly. Check safety catches are unsafe.
And if you have a choice between two courses, one daring and one cautious, take the daring one where the risks are calculated. Not foolhardy. There is nothing foolhardy about initiative based upon sound knowledge. For any would-be leader, knowledge is vital. Try to know as much as those above you. You might have to take their place if they're killed or wounded. Study history and learn all you can about your potential enemy. But above all, know your own men, their individual abilities and problems.
Dismount!
Only then will the corporal be certain that he can lead his section, or the general his division. Last but not least is integrity. General Farrah Hockley, who was adjutant of the Gloucesters in Korea, quotes Bill Slim's definition of integrity.
It really means that men trust you. But they won't trust you unless you have that. It's the old-fashioned Christian virtue of self-sacrifice. You've got to love your neighbour more than you love yourself. If you do that, your men will follow you everywhere. Let me give you an example of this in practice. Serving with us in the 1st Gloucesters in Korea was a young officer of the West Yorkshire Regiment called Terry Waters. During the action at the Imjin River, he was severely wounded in the head, and he had a painful wound in the arm besides that. Captured, he set off on the journey north to Pinyang with other prisoners. And with those prisoners, as the citation for his George Cross says, he set a magnificent example of courage and fortitude in remaining with wounded soldiers on the march, whom he felt it his duty to care for to the best of his ability. Subsequently, after a journey of immense hardship and privation, the party arrived at an area adjacent to PW Camp 12, known generally as the Caves, in which they were held captive. They found themselves imprisoned in a tunnel driven into the side of a hill, through which a stream of water flowed continuously, flooding a great deal of the floor, in which were packed a great number of South Korean and European prisoners of war, in rags, filthy, crawling with lice. In this cavern, a number died daily from wounds, sickness, or simply starvation. They fed on two small meals of boiled maize daily. Of medical treatment, there was none. Lieutenant Waters appreciated that few, if any, of his numbers would survive these conditions in view of their weakness and the absolute lack of attention for their wounds. After a visit from a North Korean political officer who attempted to persuade them to volunteer to join a prisoner of war group known as peace fighters, that is, active participants in the propaganda movement against their own side, with the promise of better food, of medical treatment, and other amenities as a reward for such activity, an offer that was refused unanimously, he decided to order his men to pretend to accede to the offer in an effort to save their lives. This he did, giving the necessary instructions to the senior other rank with the British party, Sergeant Hooper, that the men would go upon his order without fail. Whilst realizing that this act would save the lives of his party, he refused to go himself, aware that the task of maintaining British prestige was vested in him. Realizing that they'd failed to subvert an officer with the British party, the North Koreans now made a series of concerted efforts to persuade Lieutenant Waters to save himself by joining the camp. This he steadfastly refused to do. He died a short time after. He was a young, inexperienced officer, comparatively recently commissioned from the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst. Yet he set an example of the highest gallantry.
It is indeed a fact that a leader's qualities are more apparent when he is up against it. For as Slim said,
the test of leadership comes not so much when you are winning as when you are taking a hammering.
Who better to know than he? For he stared defeat in the face in Burma and turned it by the very greatest leadership into victory. But where can we find our military leaders today? At school? In previous generations, young leaders were easier to find. Today, we live in a very much freer society, which appears to be softer and less challenging. It is easier to relax with the system rather than step out and lead.
Good afternoon, lads.
Here, at an Army Youth Selection Center for the NCOs of the future, the problem is put this way by the Commandant.
The leadership potential is still there, as it ever was. But you have to dig deeper to find it. That's our job. You're here because you may be selected to serve your country and your fellow citizens, and when you're promoted, to serve them unselfishly as a leader. You may be called out on a Sunday at 1 a.m. to help rescue people from floods, perhaps to fight forest fires. In fact, to help in any sort of emergency in which self-discipline, self-sacrifice, and leadership are required. Finally, you may be called upon to make the most unselfish sacrifice of all, to die for what you believe in if there is no alternative.
The search for the officers of the future also demands exacting qualities. Qualities which, if he's selected, will be trained and developed later. A kind of coolness, an obvious determination. Will he get on with those around him? Has he a sense of responsibility? Will he fit into the military way of life? Can his character be developed?
It was a practical plan to his command task. He understood his problems well, and I thought he adapted well to other people's ideas. Also, there were one or two instances in other command tasks.
Now, which one did he do? He did Allen's leg?
No, Albert Canal, in fact, Brigadier.
Oh, yes, I didn't see that one. I was looking at 36, but Russell, you saw him, and you could...
Yes, give him his own command task. He was, after all, meant to be in charge.
Those who pass are offered a place at Sandhurst, either straight into the standard military course or for a preliminary course in the Rowallan Company, named after that famous chief scout and trainer of young men who welcomed potential officers to his training center in World War II with these words.
We shall test you to the last ounce of your strength, but that last rag we shall leave with you. We shall expect you to discipline yourselves, and it is up to you to do so. The things we shall teach you will be few, but I hope you will teach yourselves a lot.
Now, in the Rowallan Company, many of his methods still apply. First, they get them fit. For the fitter they are, the more able they are to cope with the physical and mental strain of leadership in battle.
Jump higher!
Right up. Don't dip your head. Keep your head straight. Lower the...
Then they are taught the basic skills.
Okay, we've tuned it into the channel now. We switch the system switch over, and we're going to do the channel adjust.
Okay, that's fine. Now, remember, not too tight. Nice and comfortable.
Okay, that's fine. Remember, we should be offering comfort to us all.
Dad, look what I just saw.
Oh, well, great.
Basic skills apart, they must learn how to survive.
Having done that, push the back legs through and pull the skin back down across the rabbit's back.
And then comes the whole object of the Rowallan course, the development of character. The ability to communicate is essential in every would-be leader.
I've just been involved in an incident with some school children. I have here Second Lieutenant Duncan, who commands the Army Detachment. Second Lieutenant Duncan, why do you shoot at school children?
Well, they certainly weren't behaving like school children, and as I'm sure you're aware, they were being used as a screen for further terrorist activity.
I see. How do you justify the shooting of the young girl?
Don't you think he's being a bit aggressive there, sir?
Yes, but
he was firm.
I mean, he did make his point clearly. What do you think about it yourself, Duncan?
Well, sir, I just thought I was taking a firm line on a very provocative and aggressive interview.
Further into the course, the training gets tougher and more demanding. Exercises and marches to increase stamina. Difficult tasks to test ability and resourcefulness. For in the Rowallan Company, the candidates are given every chance to prove themselves and develop their characters.
Came around this bend in the river. You could hear the roar ahead. Rapids. I didn't know how big they were. Sounded enormous. Frightened me to death. Anyway, whoosh, went down through the rocks like a dose of salt. You know, it wasn't as bad as I'd expected. Glad I did it now. Won't be so bad next time.
All character building. As Wavell said,
character will always beat mere brains. For character in a leader means he knows what he wants and has the courage and determination to get it.
After these intensive months in the Rowallan Company, provided they have the qualities and character that leadership demands, it's on to the standard military course. For many NCOs of the future, training starts at a junior unit where expeditions of one sort or another form part of character development.
Let me assure you that you can't just pack your rucksack and take off for the Blue Nile Gorge. One or two people have tried that and they didn't come back. Before you can go away, you've got to conquer the paper jungle. And do that before you can conquer the green one. You'll be surprised how many people think that an expedition is just a jolly good swan, in which you get away from all the administration and the paperwork. Well, that's rubbish. The success of an expedition depends almost entirely on good administration. And we've always planned these great adventures down to the last grain of salt. Now, you are here because one day you hope to lead Royal Engineers. And I must say to you, as aspiring leaders, that leadership, as well as everything else I've mentioned, involves a need to plan thoroughly and administrate efficiently, however small the project. It's marvellous to be the get-up-and-go type. Tally-ho! Follow me. That's marvellous. But don't get me wrong. You must plan, and you must make time to plan.
Now organise your group to get a badly wounded undercover agent across a rickety bridge, over a river gorge, and back to your headquarters so that he can hand over vital intelligence information.
Go on, lift it up. Take care of him.
Here,
go on.
Exercise. You can go underneath that tree over there.
You're in charge of a small patrol whose task is to ambush a guerrilla raiding party that's been causing a nuisance to the main force.
Okay, that's it.
Off. You are to instruct your team on techniques of abseiling.
Want to push yourself off? That's good. Keep leaning back.
Maximum cookers, refills, torches.
You are to lead your section on a 3-day survival exercise.
So, planning. Remember, down to the last grain of salt. The Duke of Wellington in the Peninsular Wars put it,
"It is very necessary to attend to all this detail. To trace a biscuit from Lisbon into the man's mouth on the frontier. Or no military operations can be carried on, and the troops must starve."
Move! Come on! Bring us aside!
With even the simplest exercises, a leadership debrief and honest self-analysis.
I think what I should have done...
I think it'd have been better if I...
Next time I know how I'll do it.
Gentlemen, you might think that leadership is leading your men out of the trenches, over the top and into the machine guns of the enemy. But leadership's really much more mundane than that. For example, you try emptying the naffy when the lads have had a couple of pints.
In the end, whether for potential NCOs at junior leader regiments or potential officers at Sandhurst, leadership is a very individual thing.
And so, gentlemen, you're soon going to be leading your soldiers from the front. And it's then a lot of people, leaders included, and that means you, and you, sir, are very suddenly and sharply made aware of what leadership's all about.
You can't be too rigid in the way you develop leadership, for as Slim said,
"There is nobody who cannot vastly improve his powers of leadership by a little thought and practice."
Right. We've now dealt with the tactical side of the attack. Would you like to go through in more detail the leadership points so far in the attack? Were they good or bad?
Generally, sir, I thought that I left everything just a little too slow. This was passed on through the men on everything they did.
But apart from encouraging the exercise of leadership and discussion about it in normal training, let it stretch into sport.
All right, that untidy ball in the line now, all right? The ball that's going on the deck, you're going to be first to get to it. Doesn't matter that he might be marking up close, all right? Or he's up at the back of the line, okay? I want you, the first man there, down on the ball. You're going to tidy it up at the back, all right? The long one over the top, you're going to turn to it, all right, and be the first there.
Hey, can I have your attention?
And into hobbies.
Before you go on, check you've got all your kit. We need heavy weights because the tide's flowing fast. Before we get down there, we'll have to get some bait.
Let the youngsters with a bent for aero modelling, photography, fishing, and so on take charge, organise, lead. Take them on specialist courses to develop character and confidence. And as their confidence and knowledge grow, on adventurous and external leadership training. Passing out day arrives. and you become an officer. And you, an NCO. Well done. But don't relax. Leadership is only just starting for you.
Situation. There's an enemy motor rifle division that has crossed the River Avon and is moving west towards Till's Head. Our mission is to...
Whether you're a squadron, battery, platoon, or section commander...
Get that guy up here!
Not only will you be striving to gain experience of leadership for yourself, but you will, you must, unselfishly train others and pass on to them everything you've learnt about it, particularly by example. You and they are vital links in the leadership chain of command. Let them lead as much as you can. Appoint them every so often to higher command positions than their rank. Take a genuine interest in each of them personally.
What's the matter?
Well, sir, plug's a bit damp, sir.
And not just because it's the thing to do.
She's not starting.
No, sir.
Hang on a minute. I've got some aerosol in the car. I'll just get it for you.
So, one of your junior officers or NCOs wants to go on an expedition. Encourage him to organize it. He and the men with him will gain confidence from success. And just as important, team spirit will be created. Encourage young leaders to take their own soldiers on these adventurous expeditions, which, in peace, develop self-reliance and provide the challenge of leadership for the potential pressures of war. So, come the big exercise, you'll be leading a team. A team that you've carefully blended together. And if you're leading well, it will be the best section, or the best troop, or the best squadron, or the best battalion in the best army in the world. In exercising your judgment to the limit, as you continually stretch your experience, you'll still make mistakes, but you'll be learning from them. Better now, during training, than later, when it may hurt your country or your men. So what is the ultimate leadership challenge likely to be? In Northern Ireland, young officers and junior NCOs have to take life and death decisions. Decisions normally associated with war.
Hello, four, six,
the Alpha. Seven, six, Corporal Clark, on you go. Yeah, that's all for now.
There's been a report of a gunman
in the area of the Bally Murphy. Be on the...
But Northern Ireland is not the ultimate operation for the exercise of leadership. The greatest challenge will come if and when we are faced with all-out war. In Northwest Europe, we have a potential enemy that is highly trained, has every advantage of surprise, is vastly superior in numbers, with thousands of tanks and massive air support. Nothing between them and our people except the smaller forces of NATO.
Come on, Alt, it's real, it's no far call. Let's go, move yourselves. Come on, Daddy, hurry up. Come on, you guys, let's move it.
If this ever happens, we must measure up to the challenge. For as Sir Winston Churchill said in 1940,
"But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science."
Now is the time when everything you have learned will be put to the test. Remember Harding's warning?
You have got to be able to exercise leadership in conditions of fatigue and fear, uncertainty and ignorance, and often in isolation. That is why leadership on the battlefield calls for the very highest qualities.
No time to sift out and select the real leaders. They've got to be in action now. Leadership is the most personal thing in the world. For as Slim said,
leadership is just plain you.
Dismount!
How would you measure up to this challenge?